what I mean?
Right.
So, as far as I know.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the City of Muskegon City Commission meeting for April 11, 2017. Before we begin the proceedings, I'd like to invite up Pastor Tim Cross to lead us in prayer. If anyone would like to join us, please stand. And after the prayer, we will have the Pledge of Allegiance. Pastor?
Would you bow your heads with me, please? Father, we approach you as your word says, that you're really judge and you're really ruler and sovereign over the entire earth. Your word says that the earth is yours and the fullness thereof, even Muskegon, Michigan. So, Father, I pray that you would teach each of us, and those on this commission as well, maybe even a fresh respect and reverence for you. You said that rulers were to rule in the fear of the Lord. So, Father, I pray that you would teach us how to fear and how to respect you and respect your ways and respect your laws. Father, and I pray for this commission that you would grant them wisdom and our city officials wisdom as they really deal with the day-to-day intricacies of this city. And Father, I pray that you would deliver them from those that would try to influence and pull them in ways that are not in line with your kingdom and with your word and your will. So Father, I pray that you would give each of them an understanding, a fresh understanding of your will and your purposes, O God. Because every one of us will have to give an account for you for the decisions that we make, whether they line up with your will and your way. Father, I thank you for this. I thank you for helping each of us. In the name of Jesus, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Pastor. May we have the roll call, please?
Commissioner Rinsema-Sibiga?
Here.
Commissioner Turnquist? Absent. Commissioner Johnson?
Here.
Mayor Galran?
Here.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Here.
Commissioner Warren?
Here.
Commissioner German?
Here.
Thank you. Before we get into the meat of things, I'd like to invite up, you look kind of familiar, Jay. Did we grow up together? Oh, we did. Jay Vandervoorde. Is here to speak about the Lumberjack Charitable Foundation.
And, thank you.
Jay has joined us before, and it's great to have you back.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Last year I came and I addressed the City Commission. I showed you one of the children's books that were written and how we go out into the community to promote literacy reading. The owner approached me last summer, and I said I would come back and let you know how things went. Approached me last summer, and I decided with his twisting of arms that I would take over their 501(c), whatever we call these things, and run the Charitable Foundation with John Snyder. And I'm secretary treasurer and retired, and I went to a lot of schools this year. We put this booklet together. We're just finishing up this year. And I think the main thing that you would like to see probably is you can see who's on the foundation from the community, a lot of community leaders. But the middle of the book has the Reading Caravan schools. And projected for next year, two Muskegon schools will be in, Nelson probably also. Jennifer Halverson as principal out at Lakeside did a tremendous job this year. And Lakeisha Laudermill, Williams, principal at Oakview, has already called me a couple weeks ago and says, we want to be in this. From what we're hearing, we need to be in this. And so there will be at least two or three Muskegon public schools in there. If you flip the page over, numbers, what we did from the middle of February to the end of March for reading month, every day I was in a school where the team did not play, Monday through Friday. If they weren't playing, I was in a school with players. If they were traveling or something, there's no way the players could do it. But we made about 22 visits in March, and when you consider they have games Friday and some Mondays they were still traveling, it was pretty hectic for the players. But the owners committed to do this. We have some big donors, but 126 total classes. this year, projected next year with the new schools that have already come to us. We have not been going out soliciting schools anymore. 204 classes, 12 districts this year in the county, 14 next. I think we'll just about be every district next year, including charter schools and private schools. 13 total schools this last year, 17 next year. 3,168 total students, and that next year we're looking at about 4,500 students. It will probably be more because some of the schools, it was just two or three classes. Entire buildings want to get involved now. And the next page there, we are also going to pair up with a nursing home at Sanctuary at Macaulay. But the students read, and the foundation provides awards for those students that reach their goals. And the next page shows how many awards the first marking period with backpacks. The next time we gave a ticket, and Sherman Bowling Alley gave bowling away for the entire month of February for students that met their goal. And then the last one, they're going to get T-shirts, which are being printed now and will be delivered next Monday, Tuesday. So we are continuing to make a lot of outreach into the county, into the city of Muskegon, and the players absolutely love it. The last two pages are players that qualified for the playoffs in college that went through Muskegon the last 6 years. There's also 16, 18, I'm not sure, that are playing professionally, minor league, or in the NHL. Griffin Molino played for Western Michigan University, was here last year, I believe. He played for Vancouver at the end of the season. He was pulled up already. So you have players that played at the Walker Arena that are playing in the NHL now, two or three of them. So good news. Matt DeBlau contacted me, and Steve Garwin had made a good contact with me a couple months ago because a player, former player, that helped with the first and second book said, Jay, I want to do another book, and I want to do it about Muskegon because when I get a job and I'm done playing hockey, I'm moving back to Muskegon. And so we are doing a children's book on Pier Marquette Park. The two of us are pairing up, and we've met with some city officials to help us out with that. So good news, good volunteers. The players love the area. Hopefully we can continue doing a good job with it. Questions, sir?
Jay, for all your efforts, all your work, you, the Lumberjacks, the players, the team administration, everything, we just want to thank you so much for your engagement with the community, with the kids, especially with this essential initiative of getting people to read. Commissioner?
Yeah, I just want to add to that. My son's a 8-year-old and in one of the participating schools, and I think it was the highlight of his week when they came and read to the class, and he was very excited about them coming to school. He loves going to the Walker Arena and watching the Lumberjacks, so I know that it wasn't just him who likes hockey. It was a lot of the kids in the school were excited and excited about reading because they have some goals related to that, and they really appreciate that.
So. Yeah, thank you very much. When we go into schools, the teachers, the students have been very excited this year about it, and we really, really got our act together. Everything's planned out well, and that's why we're getting schools calling us now that we want to be part of this. So it's a good thing, and hopefully it will continue.
Very good.
Thank you again, Jay.
Thanks very much.
Yes. Yeah, and I'd just like to commend you also on your work that you're doing in the community. And as an educator myself, it is so important that these kids read above their grade level. And that initiative that you're pushing, I'd like to congratulate you and your organization. And keep up the good work, and look forward to seeing more progress.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Okay. And they made the playoffs, so in a couple weeks
Absolutely.
Here, next week, they're going to be playing Thursday, Friday. Everybody can come down and see them play.
That's good. Go Lumberjacks, huh?
Yep.
Thank you. Oh, look. We have State Representative Terry Sable in the audience. Welcome, Terry.
Thank you, Mayor. And Commission, I appreciate it. I just stopped in to say hi, and I don't get too many Tuesdays off where I'm not in Lansing, and I had the opportunity today to not go to Lansing, so I wanted to make sure I stopped by here to say hi and see if you had anything for me to take back to Lansing with me. I know I can tell you that we've been very hard at work in the first 3 months on the job. Now that I'm a seasoned veteran of 3 months, I should say. So, and we've been very hard at work with the Muskegon Heights school situation, which really affected a lot of the different communities around here and school systems. But also, as well as environmentally. You know, with the president's suggestion to do funding cuts to the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, we've made a stand on that, to along with several of my colleagues on both sides of the aisle, to really encourage the president and Congress to revisit this and not jeopardize what we have going on here with our Great Lakes and our waterways. And then also something you'll probably be reading about more, if not, if you haven't already, is the situation with Nestle and their DEQ permit. Even though it isn't necessarily happening here in Muskegon County, I really believe that the effects of it, we want to make sure that the effects of it are not going to be affecting Muskegon County. That's my number one concern. So seeing that we are downriver from where they want to pull this additional water from. So that's definitely on my radar, and I'll simply say that, you know, for some of you on the commission that are not aware of it, that, you know, I've got a great relationship working with your mayor and with the city manager. We've got direct contacts with each other. It's really nice to be able to have that in Lansing, so that, you know, if I have a question, I can pick the phone up and call one of these gentlemen and get an answer or get an opinion on something. So that's very, very helpful, and I want to make sure that I expect that from you as well. If you ever have any issue you want me to know about or a question, feel free to give me a call, and I'm definitely available to you, as I do work for you. So, and you know, the mayor joined me at the State of the State speech here a couple months ago, left his umbrella down there. We're still looking for his umbrella on the House floor, but we have not found it yet, by the way. We're still working on it, though, so. So I'll leave it at that. Again, it's a privilege for me to be serving as your state representative, and I'm happy with the relationship that I have with all the municipalities in my district, including right here in the city of Muskegon.
Thanks, Derek.
Okay, thank you.
Great to see you.
Thank you.
Here we have the consent agenda, please.
Approval of minutes, city clerk summary request to approve minutes of the March 28, 2017 regular city commission meeting. Staff recommendation, approval of the minutes. Fireworks display permit for Muskegon Country Club, city clerk, summary request. Melrose Pyrotechnics Incorporated is requesting approval of a fireworks display permit for July 2nd, 2017 at the Muskegon Country Club, 2801 Lakeshore Drive. The fire marshal will inspect the fireworks on the day of the event. Staff recommendation, approval contingent on inspection of the fireworks and approval of the insurance. Fireworks display permit for Heritage Landing, city clerk. Summary request. Night Magic is requesting approval of a fireworks display permit for July 4th, 2017 at Heritage Landing. The fire marshal will inspect the fireworks on the day of the event. Staff recommendation, approval contingent on inspection of the fireworks and approval of insurance. 2017 CDBG Home Budget Recommendations, Community Neighborhood Services. Summary request. To accept the recommendations of the administration in regards to the 2017 CDBG home budget allocations and publish the budgets and annual action plan for public comments. Budget action required to direct staff to publish the proposed budgets for the 2017 CDBG home allocations and the annual action plan for public comment. Special event request, Catamaran Racing Association of Michigan. Request to allow overnight camping at Pierre Marquette Park in conjunction with their annual catamaran sailing regatta planning. Summary request. CRAM is holding their annual catamaran sailing regatta at Pierre Marquette Park the weekend of July 28th through the 30th, 2017. They are again requesting permission for their participants to camp overnight at the park as they have done in previous years. We are requesting that the commission authorize staff to issue this approval annually and negotiate any terms associated with the request if the city-owned parking lot across from the Deck restaurant is utilized. The Deck's owner, Harris Hospitality, will be engaged in the approval process. They approved it last year and have indicated approval of the 2000 event as well. Staff recommendation to authorize staff to approve the overnight camping as part of the CRAM Sailing Regatta at Pierre Marquette parking beginning with the planned 2017 event. Lease proposal for Matt Kite Kiteboarding School at Pierre Marquette Park. Department of Public Works, summary request. Staff is asking permission to enter into a three-year contractual agreement for 2017, 2018, and 2019 with Steve Nagin of Matt Kite for a kiteboard school and shop at Pierre Marquette Park at 1955 Beach Street, former Old Brown Brick Beach House building by the water filtration plant. Staff is also asking permission to negotiate with the lessee for in-kind services and or donation to Pierre Marquette Park facilities in lieu of the standard lease payment. Staff recommendation, approve the request. Intake inspection, water filtration, DPW. summary request. Authorize staff to sign the contract. Staff recommendation to approve the contract for $62,161. Staff recommendation, staff be authorized to contract with Great Lakes Docks and Materials at a cost of $62,161. West Sludge Pump Replacement Water Filtration, DPW, summary request. Authorize staff to contract with Franklin Howarda for the replacement of our West Sludge Pump at a cost of $25,868. Staff recommendation, staff be authorized to sign the contract. High Service Pump Number 4 Valve Replacement Water Filtration, DPW, summary request. Authorize staff to contract with Northern Boiler and Mechanical at an estimated cost of $70,700. Staff recommendation, staff be authorized to sign the contract with Northern Boiler at a cost of $70,700. Auxiliary Number 7 Low Service Pump Rebuild Water Filtration, DPW, summary request. Authorize staff to contract with Professional Pump Incorporated for an estimated cost of $12,835. Staff recommendation, staff be authorized to sign the contract. Alum Sludge Removal Water Filtration, DPW, summary request. Authorize staff to contract with Ottawa County Farms Landfill and Cords Trucking for an estimated cost of $37,440. Staff recommendation, staff be authorized to sign the contract. 2017-2018 Water Treatment Sodium Hypochlorite Bids Water Filtration, DPW. Summary request. Authorize staff to contract with Alexander to supply sodium hypochlorite for the water filtration plant. Staff recommendation. Staff recommends the approval of the contract with Alexander for sodium hypochlorite for 1 year beginning April 16, 2017. Amendment to the zoning ordinance R1 single family districts, second reading, planning economic development. Summary request. Staff initiated request to amend Article R1 single family residential districts to rename it R1 single family low density residential districts. Staff recommendation to approve the zoning ordinance amendment. Amendment to the zoning ordinance R2 and R3 districts, second reading, planning economic development. Summary request. Staff initiated request to amend Article 4 R1 single family residential districts to create two new categories for single family districts. These will include R2 single family medium density residential districts and R3 single family high density residential districts. Staff recommendation to approve the zoning ordinance amendment. Amendment to the zoning ordinance preamble and sections 400 and 404, second reading, planning economic development. Summary request. Staff initiated request to amend Article 4 R1 single family residential districts to amend the preamble to reflect the changes made by adding the new residential districts. To amend section 400 principal use permitted to create the allowed and special use permitted in the new residential districts and to amend section 404 area and bulk requirements to create the development standards for the new residential districts. Staff recommendation to approve the zoning ordinance amendment. Request to add parcels to the city's existing groundwater ordinance, Burgess Norton, second reading, planning economic development. Summary request. The city has received a petition from Burgess Norton Manufacturing Company Incorporated to designate 711 parcels under the water supplies ordinance. These parcels are associated with the former Standard Automotive Parts Company at 660 Nim Street. The ordinance prohibits the use of groundwater wells and secondary water supplies under certain circumstances and in certain locations to prevent exposure to contaminated groundwater as well as to prevent wells from influencing the movement of contaminated water. Notices were sent to the affected addresses prior to the meeting. Staff recommendation, approval of the ordinance amendment to include the additional 711 parcels. Request to add parcels to the city's existing groundwater ordinance, Ambrosia Street, second reading, planning economic development. Summary of request. The city has requested a petition from the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality to designate 511 parcels under the water supplies ordinance. The Ambrosia Street area groundwater contamination was discovered by a sampling conducted by the environmental consultant Arcadis of Michigan LLC for the Burgess Norton site in 2013. During that work, Arcadis not only defined the extent of the contamination plume coming from the Burgess Norton site, but also identified three other plumes of chlorinated contamination. The ordinance prohibits the use of groundwater wells and secondary water supplies under certain circumstances and in certain locations to prevent exposure to contaminated groundwater, as well as to prevent wells from influencing the movement of contaminated waters. Notice was sent to the affected addresses prior to this meeting. Staff recommendation, approval of the ordinance amendment to include the additional 511 parcels. Consideration of bids for resurfacing of Glenside from Sherman to Glen Engineering. Summary request, to award the milling and resurfacing of Glenside Boulevard to McCormick Sand Incorporated, since they were the lowest responsible bidder with a total bid price of $238,027.25. Staff recommendation, award the contract to McCormick Sand.
Commissioners, you've heard the consent agenda as presented. Are there any items you wish to have removed for further discussion? Commissioner Warren?
Item F and item K.
Any others, Commissioner? Commissioner Johnson?
There are no others. I move to approve the consent agenda as presented, minus items F and K.
Second.
Been moved by Commissioner Johnson, seconded by Commissioner German, to approve the consent agenda, minus items F and item K. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Masibiga?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item K, Commissioner Warren.
Do you want to do item F first?
Oh, item F, sorry.
I'm sorry. I move we approve the request for lease proposal for Matt Kite Boarding School at Pier Marquette Park.
Second.
Been moved by Commissioner Warren, seconded by the Vice Mayor, to approve the request for the lease proposal for Matt Kite Boarding School at Pier Marquette Park. Commissioner Warren.
My question is about some of the details. Is anybody here on behalf of the Kite Boarding School? Otherwise, maybe. Oh, great. If you could come to the podium, please. Hi, good, how are you?
Hi, we just have your name, please.
Austin Nader.
Thanks.
So my question is if it's going to be a status quo where this is what's been done before, or if the shop aspect of it is new?
The shop, we really don't have a shop there.
Okay.
It's just the school, so nothing's
okay.
Really changed.
Okay, so it'll
be like it's
to
always been, correct.
Okay, all right.
Are you gonna sign up?
Yes.
Now she
that,
likes it.
Yes. Now that I don't have a baby that I'm carrying around, yeah. I'm allowed to do fun things like that.
Very good.
Yeah, that was my only question. I appreciate you being there. Another reason I wanted you to come up here is because Pier Marquette, of course, has been a hot topic, and we've been taking a lot of resident input about what's happening there. So I think what you do there is a real value add without really having any of those permanent structures, that kind of stuff, new things. So thank you.
Great. Thanks so much for having us. We appreciate
you. Good luck for the season.
If it gets here.
Yeah, I know. It's Michigan. Any further discussion or questions? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Masibiga?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Now working our way alphabetically, item K, Commissioner Warren.
I move staff be authorized to contract for both disposal and trucking of sludge from the filtration plant.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Warren, seconded by Commissioner Johnson, to authorize the contract for both disposal and trucking of sludge from the filtration plant to Ottawa County Farms Landfill and Cordis Trucking. Commissioner Warren.
Good evening, Mr. Elchatel. So my main question, of course, water is always concerning. Whenever people are talking about water, residents, sometimes the red flags go up. Is something wrong with the water? There's sludge in our water. So could you, between the sludge and the multiple replacements that were on the consent agenda, can you just give a little bit of background if this is normal procedure, out of the ordinary, just for peace of mind for some of our residents?
Well, there is no reason for anybody to worry about the water on this side of the thing. That's for sure. Mm-hmm. This is a typical operation. The filtering process of getting the water from Lake Michigan, after they filter, they produce a sediment that we store in two cells, if you will, every other year or every when they get filled, depending on the quantities and the quality of water that we're withdrawing from the lake. We generate some sediment that we have to truck it into a landfill, and that is typical. Every once in a while, we have to do that. Mm-hmm. We allow it to dry up a little bit so it doesn't cost us more, and after it dries up, we take it to the landfill. but there is no reason for anybody to worry about the water.
Thank you for the explanation.
Anything else? Okay, thank you. Roll call, please.
Mayor Galron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rensselaer-Masibiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Public hearing, item A.
Request to establish an obsolete property district, 1121 3rd Street, Planning and Economic Development. Summary request. Pursuant to Public Act 146 of the Michigan Public Acts of 2000, Square 2 Development LLC has requested the establishment of an obsolete property district for their property at 1121 3rd Street. The establishment of the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate. Staff recommendation. Staff recommends approval of the obsolete property district.
Good evening, Mr. Franzik.
Good evening. So this request has two parts. First, we need to establish the district. Second, we need to vote on the certificate. And this is regarding the building on 3rd Street, which is next to the tattoo parlor. It was at one time going to be a bike shop, but those plans fell through. It's been vacant for well over 10 years. It's completely obsolete. It needs new electrical, plumbing, HVAC, so it's really important that we offer some type of abatement to get it up and running. And the intention is to have a gaming center on the first floor and also activities up on the second floor as well. And we have Ms. Kathy Dennison here, I believe, for any questions. She is the new owner of the building.
And I suspect there's some questions for the new owner.
I have one question, I guess.
Okay. Start with staff or the new owner?
It's directed toward the owner. Is this a business that you're moving that's been in existence, or is this something that you're just starting now?
If you would please come up and give your name, please.
Good evening. I'm Kathy with Lighthouse Property Management. The person wanting to put the business in is a renter. He's a native of Muskegon who moved to Chicago and is looking to move home to start a business. So it'll be a brand new business. But he recently participated in a local 5x5 start garden night here in town and made quite a splash. So I think he's got a little bit of community support behind him and some excitement.
Okay. And you say gaming. On the first floor, what type of gaming?
What he's proposing is a retail store on the lower level, which will sell board games,
okay.
A little bit of video gaming, but I think his passion, I've been following him on Facebook, and I think his passion is the live action role playing, and I think we have a couple of those businesses in town, but he has quite a following. In the upstairs level right now, they're looking at doing like a gaming center, activity center, also incorporating some family nights. This building's pretty close to Muskegon High School, and so maybe trying to tie in some kind of community involvement activities in that as well. For ADA purposes, we also have some space designated on the main floor to make sure that we can do any accommodations that we need to for the property.
Okay, that's good. Okay. No. I was just going to ask you, what would the hours be? You have any ideas what the hours would be? And that 5 days a week, six days?
You know
days?
What? We were really anxious to get started, and when I walked by there about an hour ago, he already has his name and hours posted on his stickers on the doors. But I didn't read them, so I think he knows. Yeah. I can try and find out for you.
And the reason why I ask, also, you know, that's the ward that I'm over, and I can just stop in and, you know, congratulate him. And,
yeah, you know. That would be great. I know that he wants to tie it, because he's not offering food, just the gaming activities. He really is excited to tie into the food establishments that are opening on 3rd Street. So I think he'll be trying to make sure that he's kind of accommodating or there during their hours, maybe.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Johnson?
I'm just wondering, this is a property that you own, or Lighthouse Property Management owns and is rehabbing and is going to be leasing to the game store?
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Excellent. So happy to see that building finally going to be rehabbed and put to use. And it's right in line with the growing direction, the burgeoning direction of our Midtown, newly anointed Midtown district. So there's a lot of exciting things happening over there on 3rd Street. I know your offices are not too far from there as well, and so I'm happy to see that you and your company is taking a more active approach throughout, not only the residential, but getting into the commercial aspect as well. So, yeah, this is exciting.
Thank you. That is a new move for us. So we're learning a lot. This is a learning curve for us. We're excited.
Hopefully we'll see you invest in more commercial properties and help rehab and really be a stronger part of our developing and growing downtown. So,
thank you.
And appreciate throughout it. Our city. Thank you.
Thanks. So then we can go get a burger, buy an album, game, and then go to the Y to learn how to be healthy after we've eaten the burger. Right, Commissioner Warren?
Yeah, that sounds like a fun day. Yeah.
There you go. There you go. Well, thank you very much.
Good. Thank you very much.
Are there any members of the public that would like to address the issue of the obsolete property district at 1121 3rd Street? If not, Vice Mayor?
I move to close the public hearing and approve the obsolete property district.
Second.
It's been moved by the Vice Mayor, seconded by Commissioner Rensselaer-Sabinga to close the public hearing and approve the obsolete property district for 1121 3rd Street. Any further discussion, commissioners? If not, roll call, please.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rensselaer-Sabinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Public hearings item B, please.
Request to issue an obsolete property certificate. Square 2 Development LLC Planning Economic Development. Summary request. Pursuant to Public Act 146 of the Michigan Public Acts of 2000, Square 2 Development LLC has requested the issuance of an obsolete property certificate for their property located at 1121 3rd Street. The estimated cost for rehabilitation of this property will be $75,000, which qualifies the applicant for an abatement of 8 years. Staff recommendation: staff recommends approval of the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate.
You have anything for part two?
Just that it's a standard 6-year abatement. You get off the bat and they get 2 additional years for the amount of money they're investing.
Okay. Any questions for Mike? Commissioner Warren?
So I was expecting to see it going to Lighthouse. So who's the Square 2 Development?
Square 2 Development is the LLC.
Oh, that, okay.
The holding entity.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any members of the public that would like to speak to the actual approval of the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate? Commissioner Warren?
I move we close the public hearing and approve the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate.
Second.
It's been moved by Commissioner Warren, seconded by Commissioner German, to approve the obsolete property rehabilitation exemption certificate for the project at 1121 3rd Street. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rensselaer-Sabinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Public hearing, item C.
Request to create a new neighborhood enterprise zone district at 351 West Western Avenue, Planning Economic Development. Summary request. Pursuant to Public Act 147 of the Michigan Public Acts of 1992, 351 West Western LLC has requested to create a new neighborhood enterprise zone district for the parcel at 351 West Western Avenue for a new mixed-use building. The NEZ would only affect the 20 proposed apartments and not the commercial space. Staff recommendation to hold a public hearing.
You still here, Mike?
Still here.
Okay.
So we sent out letters to the taxing jurisdictions on March 9th. From that date, you have to wait 60 days to vote on the creation of the district. And in between that time, we have to hold a public hearing. So that's what we're doing here today.
Very good. Any questions for staff, commissioners? Are there any members of the public that would like to speak to the creation of the neighborhood enterprise zone for 351 West Western Avenue? Not. Commissioner Rensselaer-Sabinga.
I know, I think the owners are in the audience and they were here a couple weeks ago and explained their project at 351 West Western with the 6-story building with the first phase. So I think we're all excited about that, and hope you keep moving forward with the different steps that it takes to make that happen. And I move that we close the public hearing.
Second.
It's been moved by Commissioner Rinsma-Savinga, moved by Commissioner Warren to close the public hearing and create a new neighborhood enterprise zone district at 351 West Western Avenue. Discussion, commissioners? Commissioner Johnson?
Just had a question. I noticed that the staff recommendation is just to hold the public hearing, not to hold the public hearing and approve. Is that just an omission, or does the staff recommend creation of the district itself as well?
No, we're not going to be voting on anything today. It's just to hold the public hearing.
Okay,
we'll come back.
Solely for the hearing. Yes. Okay.
Come back on May 9th for that.
Okay, so March 9th is sent out 6 days later.
Yep.
Gotcha. Okay, this satisfies the public hearing.
Just yes. Satisfies.
Okay. Thank you for that, Claire.
I was on a roll.
I was ready to vote on it.
Yeah, me too. You guys got to watch me, Counselor.
I made the motion just to close it, but got a little ambitious there. Like,
roll call, please.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsma-Savinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gallran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. New business, item A.
City-County Cooperative Agreement, City Manager, Summary of Request. As part of the reorganization of division and department head duties at City Hall, staff is requesting the creation of an economic development coordinator position to work directly with the city manager's office to facilitate economic development related opportunities. Initially, we would like to fill this position on a contractual basis by partnering with Muskegon County to share their current economic development coordinator. Staff is requesting a one-year agreement with Muskegon County to provide us time to evaluate the cooperative agreement. The agreement calls for the sharing of the costs associated with the position on a 60-40 basis, with the city contributing 40% of the costs associated with the position. The city's portion of those expenses is expected to equal $48,382.17 in the first year. Staff recommendation to approve the request and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign an agreement.
Commissioner Johnson.
I move to approve the request and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the agreement.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Johnson, seconded by the vice mayor, to approve the request and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the agreement regarding the creation of the economic development coordinator position to work directly with the city manager office. Who is this guy anyway?
Go to there, I stand.
Oh, hi, Jonathan. How are you? You brought a friend along. I'd like to also recognize, if people haven't met him yet, Jonathan Wilson. And this evening, we're also graced with the presence of County Administrator Mark Eisenbarth. Hi, Mark. Questions, comments? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Rinsma-Savinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gallran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. New business item B, please.
Comprehensive settlement and termination agreement with Burgess Norton, Planning Economic Development, summary request. The proposed agreement would resolve open items remaining from a 2011 Memorandum of Understanding and tolling agreement between Burgess Norton and the city. Staff recommendation, authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the comprehensive settlement and termination agreement.
Commissioner Rinsma-Savinga?
I move we authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the comprehensive settlement and termination agreement in regards to Burgess Norton.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Rinsma-Savinga, supported by Commissioner Johnson, to authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the comprehensive settlement and termination agreement with Burgess Norton. Hi, Mike.
Hey. So this is just to, this agreement's to resolve some of the open items remaining from the MOU and tolling agreement. We do have Mr. James Enright here from representing Burgess Norton. He's the one that drafted the agreement. Mr. Schreier looked it over. So between those two and myself, we should be able to answer any questions you have.
Very good. Questions for staff or the representatives from Burgess Norton, commissioners? Commissioner Rinsma-Savinga?
What were some of the open items?
I will let Mr. Enright talk about that.
Evening, Mr. Enright.
Hi.
If we could just have your full name for the record.
I'm please. James P. Enright. I'm outside legal counsel for Burgess Norton Manufacturing Company. The question was, what are some of the outstanding open items that the agreement would wrap up? In 2011, when we were all at an earlier stage of dealing with the groundwater contamination that you all acted on earlier in this meeting, a couple of things came up. One was the discovery of groundwater contamination in a city-owned well that provided irrigation water for the cemetery and McCrae Playfield. In the circumstances of the time, and given the location of that well, we all believed that it seemed likely that that contamination came from the Burgess Norton Standard Auto Parts property. And the city asked us, since the well was not going to be used any longer, to pay for the additional water that had to be purchased from the water supplier in order to carry out that irrigation. And so every year the city would send us a bill for that, and we paid that for several years. What developed later in the investigation was that apparently we're not actually responsible for that contamination in that well, at least in all likelihood. And so we'd like to be out from under the responsibility to keep on paying those water bills. What the agreement provides for, among other things, is we're not going to seek any reimbursement of the prior bills we paid. That can stay in the city's hands as is. And also we're paying an additional sum of money named in the agreement to kind of wrap up further obligations, whatever they might be with the city, as well as to provide some compensation to the city for the next item on your agenda, which is a restrictive covenant on several parcels of city-owned land. Also, there was a tolling agreement in place which stopped the running of the statutes of limitation in the event that there was going to be any kind of litigation between the city and Burgess Norton on this. What I think of it as a statute of limitations is like a shot clock in a basketball game. You got to make your move or else you lose the ball. What the tolling agreement did was it stopped the running of the shot clock while we all learned more and tried to see what the actual situation was. Now that we do know more, and the shot clock itself started running again last August, we decided to just get that tolling agreement out of the way so it's no longer any possible issue between the city and Burgess Norton. That's the gist of it. We do pledge further cooperation. There's nothing in the agreement that prevents either side from cooperating with the other. Our cooperation from the city has been excellent throughout this process. There's a lot that the city facilitated, for example, authorizing us to do a lot of the investigation in using city rights of way, and we hope that the cooperation the city received from us has also been viewed as very good.
We do appreciate the relationship through these years.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Commissioner German?
Yes, just for the record, doing the investigation with the contamination, has there been any contamination with just city water, drinking water, reported or anything?
The city's drinking water comes from Lake Michigan, so that supply is not affected by this at all. Mm-hmm. And to the extent that there are some wells in the area, they were either used and perhaps still are being used until the ordinance takes effect for irrigation purposes. Or in one case, there was a commercial user of groundwater in its operation, and that user and that use has ceased. I should say the user remains in business, the use has ceased.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments, questions? Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
May I have the roll call, please?
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Mississippi?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. New business item C, please.
Restrictive covenant for certain city-owned parcels, planning and economic development. Summary of request. During testing for the Burgess Norton contamination, it was discovered that some of the groundwater located south of Ryerson Creek between Getty Street and approximately 750 feet west of Wood Street contains trichlorethene, TCE, and other associated chlorinated volatile organic compounds. In most of the area where TCE is present, it is located in groundwater at depths of 70 to 90 feet beneath the ground surface. As the groundwater migrates northward and nears Ryerson Creek, it migrates through sediments in the floodplain that are rich in organic matter and biological activity. These sediments tend to be located in areas within wetlands or beneath the bottomland of Ryerson Creek. Extensive sampling has documented that as the groundwater travels through these sediments, the TCE and associated compounds degrade significantly through biochemical processes. The purposes of this restrictive covenant is to preserve this natural system so that the degradation and process continues to occur. Staff recommendation: authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the restrictive covenant.
Yes, sir.
All right. So we own some property south of Ryerson Creek where some of these compounds were found. The organic sediment has a way of naturally cleaning it. So as it flows through there, we don't want to do anything to disturb that sediment. So that's what this agreement would do.
That will leave it natural for
it to do some self-cleaning.
Long time.
Correct.
Yeah, for the purification process. Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Beautiful area. Okay. Questions for staff? Commissioner Johnson?
Well, I move to authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the restrictive covenant.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Johnson, seconded by Commissioner Enzema Saving to authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the restrictive covenant. Covering certain city-owned parcels, as stated. And now we can continue with the discussion.
Questions or comments?
Anything else? Nothing else?
No.
Okay. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galvin?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Massipiga?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Counselor. Any other business, Commissioners? At this time, we'd like to open the floor to public comment. Any of our neighbors are invited to come up if they wish to share with the commission. Each individual is allotted 3 minutes in the interest of time and courtesy to other individuals that may want to speak. Unless those minutes are rearranged by prior arrangement, right, Jane? Oh, okay. I know we do have a number of individuals here regarding the topic of vacation rentals and the topic of fees. Right off the bat, I do want to let people know that a lot of this fee discussion grew out of some charrettes that we held publicly last year in discussing Paramarquette Park and some of our other holdings. Revenue generation issues came up, etc. At this point, it's still a concept or a discussion. The commission is not at this time in any position to make any determinations because there's nothing to determine. We talked about it yesterday evening. So if you are here to speak on it, please give your information. We're not in a position to give any answers because there is no program. And again, it's a concept. However, the city manager has indicated that should anyone wish, he would be more than willing to meet with any of the interested parties to get their information and their data. As well, the commission continues to move forward on these type of topics and other ones. We will be holding additional public meetings and probably meetings with any affected property owners to gain any additional input. But at this time, I'd like to invite up Stan Denman.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to defer my position in talking about the subject of vacation rentals in the city of Muskegon to last in regards to everybody else here that wants to talk about the same subject.
Okay.
Could I do that, please?
You can. We'll just jump ahead. And if you still want to talk, I'll catch you.
Yeah, it would probably take a little bit about, you know, I don't want to repeat what they're going to say.
Okay.
You already said what I was going to say, in fact, you know?
We're still out for coffee tomorrow, though.
Are you buying?
Of course I will. Okay.
All right. But, you know, 4:30, it's got to be decaf.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah,
me too.
I thought it was going to be in the morning.
Jeff Vorges.
Hi, Mr. Mayor. I think at this point I'd like to defer myself as well, because since, as you pointed out, it is a revenue-generating idea or concept, I don't really want to put the cart before the horse.
Okay.
I'm going right to say I'm against it, but that's all.
Right. But yeah, but in the interim, be assured, we would invite anybody's, you know, contact, you know, through the days, the weeks, the months ahead, you know, just to get whatever observations or input you may have, you know. We just like to talk to y'all, okay, one way or the other. But it doesn't mean I'm buying coffee for everybody. I'm on a budget. So.
Sorry, you guys. I'll let you know how good it is.
Jane? And Jane, if we can just get your name and address, and when you see me going like this, that's the 1 minute sign.
So I have 9 minutes, right?
Right. When I do that.
When do I start?
Right now.
First, show the audience.
Can I have your name, ma'am, and address?
Jane Appleton Shepka, 1713 Rudiman Drive, North Muskegon, Michigan, 49445.
Thank you.
I'm here on the subject of the vacation renter owner's possible fees. So first I'd like to tell you a story, and then I want to give you information. So here's my story. I'm going to show the audience. I'm sure you all know some version of the English story of the goose that laid the golden egg. Here is our version. A village was fortunate to have a goose that laid one golden egg a day. The treasurer put it into the village fund for beach upkeep. One year, the villagers needed more money for their beach, so they demanded the goose lay 2 eggs per day. The goose replied, "I cannot." So the village executioner killed the goose to get the gold out in one lump sum. When they opened the goose up, it was just an ordinary goose, no gold at all. Now the village had no funds for the beach. Moral, don't kill the goose that lays the golden eggs. Now. Now I want to tell you information. Bluffton Harbor Cottages, Charming Redbird, and Cozy Eagle's Nest is what they're known by, has been giving golden eggs to Muskegon for the past 11 years. And this is not an ad. I don't want anybody to reserve with me, and Muskegon people don't make reservations anyway because we already live in the lake and we just go there. Okay. Now, normal rental homes, even short-term rentals, are for renting to other people, not for owners. Vacation rental owners are different. Vacation rentals are different. We build or rebuild VRs, short for vacation rentals, in order to have what we want on vacation. Not all owners expect to make money. Some want a nice place to have family get-togethers. Others want to make enough to pay the mortgage for a future retirement home. Vacation rentals in general are sparkling clean inside and have nice gardens and lawns outside. They have comfortable furniture, unique decor, fully furnished, have large TVs, high-speed internet, barbecue grill, fire pit, picnic tables, probably better than we have in our own homes. Furnished kitchen is for cooking and for heating up takeout or left-out food. Now, here are some of the golden eagles that Bluffton Harbor Cottages has given to Muskegon over the past 11 years. Our first golden egg, and by the way, the eggs have my business card in it, but that's just in case you ever wanted to talk to me about anything. It's not particularly to get your business. As I said, people in Muskegon, you know, they should go somewhere else. Okay, here are some of the golden eggs we have given to Muskegon over the past 11 years. Our first golden egg was that we improved the Bluffton neighborhood. We rebuilt a foreclosed potbelly stove heated house into a 5-star cottage. Property taxes went up. We serve as volunteer cheerleaders telling about the great things in Muskegon. Answer phones, emails, messages. Call me, I answer the phone. Personally, I don't have someone between me and the guests. I explain things to do in Muskegon, even if the people aren't going to stay with us. Number three, we provide local jobs for furnace man, plumber brothers, the sewer cleanout guy, the lawn, the master gardener, the maintenance fellows, and our professional housekeeper who helps us with that 5-star rating. We pay high smart TV bills and even higher high-speed internet bills. Golden egg number four, we serve as tax collectors. 5% of the Muskegon accommodations tax, that's county, and 6% state use taxes. And by the way, we pay 4% and we're grandfathered in. Number five, we can be credited with 2 home sales in Muskegon. Is there a realtor present? Listen. After staying at Charming Redbird Cottage, 2 couples in different years bought property because they love the area so much. One was by Pier Marquette Park, and the other was on High Street in Muskegon in the Nims neighborhood. Egg number 6. We added many dollars to the local restaurant's income in Muskegon. Wait! We have a furnished kitchen, and it's all modern with stainless steel and everything you could want, including the cork popper for your wine. All the guests eat in the kitchen, right? They cook there. No, or as the young folks say, not. My housekeeper frequently phones me, Jane, did they stay here? Nothing is out of place in the cupboards. They must have eaten out every meal. Who can blame them? They're on vacation. Guests write about their favorite restaurants in our Cottage Impressions book. The Deck, Habs Good Eats, Docker's Seafood, Latitude's Market, Fricano's Ice Cream Parlor, Lakeside Emporium Homemade Candy Shop, craft beers at Pigeon Hill and Unruly Brewing. Number 7, we act as a referring agency to the downtown hotels, Muskegon Harbor Holiday Inn and Shoreline Inn. I frequently refer folks there if there are no VRs available or they want to just stay one night, which is impossible for us to rent out because the cleaning cost is so high. Our last golden egg. We consider always our wonderful neighbors, and we make sure that our guests know that the friendly, artistic Save Our Dunes neighborhood is a working neighborhood, and Redbird and Eagle's Nest are not party houses. We have never had a complaint from the neighbors. Last of all, let's talk about money. When you look at some of the nightly rates, you think, wow, VR owners are really making a lot of money. Maybe some do. We do not. I've already mentioned some of the people and companies that we pay. I'm on duty 24/7. I manage the entire business, and I work for free because our accountant says I don't make enough to pay myself. Now, you ask, what is wrong with her? Why is she continuing? Question. Do you ever give to a charity or a cause that you believe in, and do you feel good about doing good? Giving our golden eggs, promoting Muskegon, makes me feel proud and feel good. But any fee is a penalty, and unreasonable or excessive fees drive away businesses. Vacation rental owners deserve praise, not a penalty, and certainly not a fee. Having to pay a penalty fee of any amount would cause me to rethink whether or not I want to continue providing golden eggs to Muskegon. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I think they could hire you at the Convention and Visitors Bureau. Seriously.
I think
that's good.
Might be nice. Might be fun.
That's nice. Corinne Kafta?
Do I need to go up and I sit?
You have to come up so that we can hear you.
Hello.
Just get your name and address. And
my name is Corinne Kafta, and I'm from the Beechwood neighborhood, and I'd like to talk about the vacation rental. And really, Jane just did a fantastic job of, you know, touching on all the points I wanted to touch on and more. But I feel the same way about Muskegon, and you know, I feel like we vacation rental people should be working for the Visitors Bureau, because I think we all just feel like we're cheerleaders for Muskegon, and I really want to. The reason I think I started a vacation rental, it's a full-time job, not a full-time job for me, but I am the full-time manager as well. And it's something that I spend a lot of time talking to people personally, and have lots of brochures about different businesses in the area, also boating businesses, charter businesses, kayaking businesses, you know, kite boarding, although a lot of people aren't that adventurous yet. But I just feel like, you know, it's something that I feel really passionate about. And it's just, you know, something that I wanted to share with other people as far as Muskegon goes. And I really feel like, you know, we are paying double property taxes. You know, it's a second home, so we're paying the double property taxes already, and we pay the county and the state taxes as well. So, thank you.
You betcha. Thank you. Stan, any follow-up at this point?
Are we there already?
We're there already.
I thought there was 5 or 6 more people here. I misjudged.
Well, that's the all the formal requests I had at this point. Oh. So, and you were one. You were the first one. So
I'll try to be very informal in my presentation.
We just need your name and address for the record, Stan.
I'll be glad to state that my name is Stan Denman, and I do live at 2155 Bluffton Avenue in Muskegon, Michigan. The zip code is 49441. And thank you again, Mr. Schreier, for not buying that lot and allowing us to build a home on it. It's a place that we love dearly now, and have enjoyed it for 20 years. Inside joke. Not joke. Anyway, I really, you know, being up here right now, I really want to personally thank all of you people sitting up here for the past, you know, week and a half, pretty much, you know, reaching out and calling me, and you know, Commissioner Warren, you were, you know, you listened very well. I don't know, you know, good listener, and like you said, you were taking notes, and I felt good coming away from that discussion. So thank all of you for calling me. I appreciate it. This is, as you can see, a passionate subject with everybody that's here tonight, and even the people that couldn't be here. And you know, I talked to quite a few, so it kind of has a, we think, you know, a big impact if it goes beyond the concept stage. We're happy that it's just a concept right now. We hope that it stays that way, and you know, we can move on to something that would be, you know, a little more realistic, and you know, as far as we're concerned, and also that wouldn't be counterproductive.
which, you know, we like having a golden age. We feel we're sitting on a gold mine, and we all here have a gold mine, and we're in that gold mine. You know, Jane's a miner, you know, and she goes down in that mine every day, and, she brings back the gold for you guys, you know, to enjoy, you know. I mean, she works hard for it. But, you know, a fee or penalty, whatever you want to call it, that's telling your miners, well, go down there and work hard and keep making us a lot of money with all that gold, but you're going to have to take a cut in pay. We're going to cut your salary, you know, because we just can't afford to keep our operation moving along, you know, unless you work harder and make less. So, you know, that's kind of hard to take, I guess, you know, for all of us, and that's why we're here, and the people that sent you, I think a few of you got emails probably, or at least some people said they would email you concerning this.
Right. You're at the 1 minute mark.
Great.
Yeah.
I'll tell them they made their point. So anyway, as a vacation rental property owner of two small cottages in the Bluffton neighborhood, I'm concerned about this, again, whatever you want to call it, pending proposal to assess a fee to vacation rental property owners in the city of Muskegon. I've discussed this with our manager, Mr. Frank Peterson, yesterday on the phone. If it advances, I want to be informed before this goes to vote anywhere. Work sessions, committee meetings, etc. I want my thoughts to be heard at all junctures of any public forum. I want to be apprised to any input whatsoever. Mayor Gowron, can you publicly tell me that this will definitely happen? You have stated it once, but can you reiterate that this will happen and this matter will be given every opportunity to be addressed by any and all persons, including myself? We deserve as many proper forums to express our feelings as well as anyone else that this matter will have an impact on.
You bet.
Okay. Now, moving along, I would really like to, at this point, read something I think very meaningful to you that best sums the feelings that, you know, so many people that I look at out here and that I see regularly down by the beach feel. And he can't be here. I would let him get up and talk too. I mean, or I wouldn't let him, you would let him. But I think he would be happy to get up here. And this gentleman is, I mean, he's another one of us unique owners that has taken on, I mean, almost an insurmountable job of remodeling Bluffton Church. Are you people familiar with that particular building?
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of like the fire department building down by Bunker School.
Stan, I got to start reeling in because we're already gone over time. I'm giving you a little.
Oh, okay. Here, I'll finish it right up what he had to say, and I'll read it real quick and I'll be done. Okay. As a SDR owner, we already are paying extra for inspection fees. He couldn't be here because he's having kidney dialysis. But if you could go by the church and check it out, what he's doing and all the thousands of dollars he's doing investing, I think you'll be impressed. Okay, we're paying extra for inspection fees, maintenance, improvements, etc. The city should be thrilled that we are doing this, investing time and finances. These rentals didn't exist, business revenues would be decreased. As a matter of fact, I would counter their proposal with a demand for a credit to the owners who invest significant funds to improve and maintain properties. Would they prefer a bunch of poorly maintained slum properties that barely meet minimal standards and rent to the bottom of the barrel tenants? As you know, many of us are putting our finances on the line. We're exerting lots of effort to operate a good quality rental. Personally, I find the proposed tax to be outrageous and insulting. Now, we already pay our fair share of tax for our properties. The long-term renter pays rent. They're entitled to use the beach just like everyone else. Why should short-term rentals create any extra burden? I completely understand the desire to generate income to help cover maintenance costs. I propose several schemes which are similar to the other municipalities and what they do in Michigan, around the country, around the world, essentially pay parking for non-residents. But no, they refuse to listen to that because they figure that they have the property owners by the bleep. I won't tell you what he's, and can just add it to our tax bill instead of developing a system to collect fees from out of the area visitors who specifically go to the beach. Now, I thought what he said, again, pretty well sums up. I picked up my paper down at Latitude. Well, Dick, sometimes I try to stop by Gabby's and get it too. But I picked it up this morning, and right, it's like, it'll stare me in the face. Did everybody see that today, the front page?
Stan, time.
Okay, well, read it, because we're on the brink of poverty. We're just one situation away that if this fee is proposed, we will be at that level. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan. We'll see you tomorrow.
I apologize. I just can't show up.
We love you, Stan.
Well, that's all that matters.
See? Are there any other members of the public that would like to address the commission on any other topic? If not, before you make a motion, I would just like to express my good wishes and blessings to all of our brothers and sisters that are celebrating Passover, and for those of you who will celebrate Easter this weekend. Many blessings on to you. It's 1 year where the East and the West will be celebrating Easter on the same Sunday. But go with our best wishes and our thanks for your engagement here within the community and sharing a night of family and neighborly conversation. Take care. Vice Mayor.
If there's nothing else, I move to adjourn.
Second. It's been moved by the Vice Mayor, seconded by Commissioner Rinsema Savinga to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody want to stay? No? Okay. Let's go have dinner.